Hello, I am here with Chris Jansen. Chris is an artist and a Bethel graduate of 2004, is that right?
That's correct.
And currently teaches at Fresno Pacific University in California, where possibly it's warmer than it is here.
About 50 degrees here. It's pretty
Ooh. Oh,
nice.
that sounds awfully nice. It's been like zero here in Kansas this week. So great, thanks for joining us, Chris, and thanks for giving your talk that students have viewed earlier this week. I have a few questions for you, so we'll take a few minutes, and I appreciate you taking the time to answer some of these.
Oh yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So first question, what's your most meaningful project you've worked on and why?
Yeah, as you can see from this presentation, there's like, I have a lot of different tangents that I like to play around with. So, and every one of these, really just even whittling down this list into like a 30-minute presentation it always means like I have to exclude some of my children, like some of the paintings that I think are really great, some of the projects that were a lot of fun. But yeah, I think that the collaborative projects that I've taken part in that require the most work, that require the most like setting aside of, you know, all of these different meetings with different parties end up being very meaningful. I think one of those big projects was this culminating performance at the Contemporary Jewish Museum with Jesse Nathan, another Bethel grad, on this dinner project. We created this song cycle that involved a series of performances. It also involved recording, which took place mostly in my basement, our recording studio there. And so then it required figuring out a detailed schedule, coordinating with the museum, coordinating with the musicians that were involved, coordinating with like how to prepare a release for vinyl record. And when all those pieces come together, there's something like super satisfying about that. I'll leave it there. I think that's one of the ones that's working in that sort of is a driving force in my life. And I think that, man, I'm also sort of scheming other plans like that. But the as life gets complicated with like kids and taking on more leadership at a university, there are different collaborations that end up happening instead of purely aesthetic, artistic collaborations.
That's great. Yeah, and I saw a version of that collaboration in 2008 when you presented it on the convocation stage with those guys. So that's really cool. So what advice do you have for aspiring artists who don't necessarily want to become a sell as many pieces as possible artist, but still want to survive?
Yeah, I mean, that's everything, isn't it? Like that's very important, because one's definition of what like being successful as an artist really is this major sliding scale that varies from person to person. There are very few people that I know who really make their entire living 100% on selling their artwork. And so I think it's, you know, but my advice is that we all have to figure out what it is that we need for our soul. Like for me, I know that I'm going to be a depressed person if I don't make time for making art and for practicing the guitar and like setting goals specific to that endeavor. So I knew that for me personally, I need to make art. I know that if I'm being told by an exterior person that the artwork has to conform to a certain set of rigid guidelines that I don't like, I knew that this was not going to be a satisfying way of living my life. So I decided I'm going to go into an area where I can share my passion and love for this thing that I do, have some kind of a way of, you know, paying my mortgage and putting food on the table, but the expectation is also that I do this expressive thing that makes my life worth living. That's like an expression of everything, of my spirituality, of like making sense of the world, like even like a therapeutic thing. So I think it changes from person to person. The advice that I have is that I have friends who they want to get their work into museums. They want to make as much time as possible for their studio craft. And the compromise that they've made is they've found a balance between that graphic design thing that puts money in the bank account. And, you know, then they split their life, you know, at a certain point and their daily routine is going into the studio. I have friends who have just decided, well, I'm going to do woodworking projects. And that's sort of like sculpture. And then they put those down and then they practice trumpet and have this music thing on the side that they do. So I think each person really has to embrace the fact that there's no one size fits all solution here. And there's no self-help book that's going to give you a step-by-step, like, here's how you are going to decide to define success as an artist. I think we all have to figure out, like, what is it that really makes life worth living? And then set up the things that you definitely can do and find, you know, success in life with. Without feeling like you've completely lost yourself, like you're there's going to be compromises. There are going to be things in life that you don't want to do. As a professor, there are these administrative tasks that we have. I found myself in the fall as the division chair for the visual and performing arts and running the art program because my colleague was on sabbatical. And that's not necessarily, like, my plan isn't to go into upper administrative work in a college setting. I don't really want to be the dean of students or a president of a university. It's not really what makes my life tick. But, you know, every once in a while, there's some give and take in my life. And, you know, I found a place that expects that I make art. And I also, you know, give some of my time, and it's sort of like it's all a positive sum game. Like it's good. So yeah, I don't know how well that answers the question.
Yeah,
parents are concerned about students majoring in art, and I have to assure them that, like, yeah, there's plenty of work out there. There's graphic design jobs. There's we need teachers in the state of California. We need teachers. From kindergarten through high school, we need instructors. And maybe this is like a way of, you know, really satisfying what it is that you want to do with your life. Maybe making art needs to be something completely different and you find another sort of 9-to-5 job. But I think everyone has to figure that out for themselves.
Good. Speaking of you make art that is satisfying and enriching to you and not necessarily for a specific audience. One question, say more about the chili pepper and cat piece and what that represents. Oh. Is one of that question's referring to?
The chili pepper dunce cap portal to a spirit world. Yeah. I mean, it's so that piece to me, I mean, there are all of these different threads that sort of weave in and out of works as I'm making them. And so part of the drive behind that piece was taking all of these bits and pieces from, you know, previous lives, previous generations of, you know, these VHS tapes that I glued together, packing styrofoam, pieces of wood that are like left over from, you know, building frames and stretcher bars and like cobbling them all together to create something that is unified. There's the riddle of a sphinx, which is like in part referencing the sphinx cat that's on one side of the piece. It's like our lives are this puzzle, this riddle, and we're piecing them all together. And there's a way to achieve like balance, but there's also this delicateness to the balance. There's the possibility that like if you don't nourish every part of your soul, then it's gonna fall apart. So there's these stacks of rocks that relate to that balance. There's a line, you know, this strip of wood that sticks out about like a centimeter off the surface of the piece. And the chili pepper that I painted sort of goes over the top of that and bridges sort of a one side and another side. And those two different sides are also sort of representative of maybe like the earthy side on the left, that's our daily life and the tasks that have to get done. And then there's the spiritual part of one's life, that soul nourishing part that's on the other side. And there's spice and and flavor and like we need both sides. And if you go too far in one direction, then you sort of lose touch with reality. And if you're too obsessed with the earthbound stuff, then we end up with pure commercial capitalism. We end up with sort of a nihilistic hopelessness that's just like, well, we just use the resources until they're all gone and then we all die, and what's the point of everything? So so in a nutshell, maybe that's another read on that painting.
Good. Balance is good. Absolutely. Yeah.
As I look at these paintings, you know, every time I take them out, I'm thinking about, I'm reliving my life as I'm making this, the artwork. And I'm also thinking about, I'm thinking about the paintings differently too. And in hindsight, I look at that work and balance is sort of what it's all about. It's like a balance of all kinds of different forces in my life. And there's also like, I'm interested in creating mystery and abstraction. And there are certainly going to be people who find other crazy tangents to follow in the artwork. And I like that too.
Yeah, absolutely. You mentioned your profession as a teacher. As a teacher, how do you help students who don't consider themselves naturally artistic?
I mean, the great thing about visual art is, like, unlike most academic areas of study, like the sole purpose of the art instructor is to pull something out of the student that they themselves didn't anticipate. So whether one has technical ability to look at a candle and draw it or paint it in such a way that we really like can smell the wax melting, whether someone really can do these technical things or not is not really at the heart of what it is to be an artist. And so my philosophy is always to try to take each person from where they stand and use their experience and their beliefs and the things that make life fun for them. I try to pull those things out into some kind of, you know, visual form. And, you know, sometimes the end result is a piece that's unremarkable by art history, by a curatorial point of view, but really self-expression and like getting us to think differently about the world is that's really what art is about. So being naturally artistic is very overrated. Now it's also like, I know I'm constantly trying to find ways of exploring this, because this is who I'm teaching, you know, most of the time. We have about, our program has about 30 art majors in it. But that's a pretty small population compared to the like 1500 traditional undergrads at Fresno Pacific. So yeah, I'm constantly encountering people who are going into kinesiology, or they're going into education, or they're going into psychology. And I think each of these areas does come with unique things to teach me as an instructor. Like I get to share in the enthusiasm of the student and what it is that they like to read about, what it is that they're studying, what their career goals are in the future. So there tend to be little shortcuts that I can show students that make you feel good if you practice them a little bit. Just like one can sign up for taking lessons in a musical instrument, and maybe you're not going to be a virtuoso, but there are some simple patterns that you can start with and really feel good about making, even if you're not going to be a professional musician. I try to pull out the things that they're excited about. That's the key. And their excitement explaining an artwork that maybe isn't technically impressive can be a way of feeling, of giving us that excitement. All the other students in the class can feed off of that too. And ultimately then we have some kind of an appreciation for one another, regardless of natural artistic ability.
Good, thank you. Do you listen to music while you make art? And if so, does it change based on the art?
Yeah, I always listen to music when I make art. In grad school, my rule for myself in the CD era was I would always bring at least 6 CDs with me to listen from beginning to end all the way through. And if I had listened through 6 CDs, which is like there's about an hour of music on a CD, give or take. So it meant like I guaranteed my 7 days a week, 6 hour quota in the studio. Music is a way of getting rid of time. When we emphasize, when we're focused on time, we end up not getting lost in the moment. It's the water that never boils because you're staring at it problem. And really, it also relates to the work that Rachel at Bowler is doing with this concept of slowness in her research right now, her practice. Music is a way of me embracing time and getting lost in the moment. I think I could trace this love of listening to music while I'm making art as a way of getting lost in the groove. I could also connect that to studies of Buddhist meditation when I took a religion and human identity course at Bethel as an undergrad. Thich Nhat Hanh reading really changed the way that I thought about music. And so yeah, the second part of the question, like does that affect the art that I make? I think it does. I don't think that it's like if I put on a particular cool jazz album by Jim Hall from the 60s, I don't think it's gonna suddenly transform the painting into like pastel blue tones. I think it's more like I'm curating my stack of CDs, my playlist, based on wanting to challenge myself, wanting to make sure that I'm staying in the moment. And so it means I'm putting on music that is challenging. I tend to try, I mean, I'm just constantly looking for new recordings and, the same way that I nerd out about like digging deeper and deeper into the artists that I like. If I'm fascinated by a particular artist, then I want to see all of the different ways that they've solved this problem of form, all the different ways that they've used color and composition. And I love the same thing in music. So I tend to gravitate towards music that contrasts, that has elements of harmony and dissonance that's challenging. I tend to gravitate towards a type of music that is going to keep me on my toes. I think that the two definitely do interrelate. I don't think there's like an immediate algorithm, like a needle that jumps around that would tell you exactly what my paintings, like that would predict the way the painting is going to look. But yeah, the two are connected, and I cannot paint in silence. No way.
Good. Well, I could ask more questions, Chris, but we're hitting about the 20-minute point. So that's a great one that sort of wraps up some of the sight and sound aspects of your work. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to us today.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Meredith. Thanks, everyone at Bethel. Stay safe out there in Kansas and warm.
Yeah, we'll try.